Just yesterday, I was in a meeting at one of our churches, small group, four or five people, included two women. And as the meeting was concluded, we started talking about, of course, this weekend, Maundy, Thursday, Good Friday, Vigil, Sunday morning. And one of the women said, well, I just got my toes done. I want my feet to look pretty for foot washing. She got this little twinkle in her eye, a little smile on her face. And the lady sitting next to her said, nobody's going to touch my feet. And she turned and looked at me and said, you're not going to go up if there's foot washing? And she said, oh, no, nobody touches my feet. Well, maybe my husband. And then we switched subjects. Thankfully. I thought about it because it is odd, isn't it? This is a service where we, in fact, touch each other's feet. And hopefully, as we're doing so, we're praying for the person whose feet we are washing. It is a profoundly intimate act. It doesn't have the grit of what happened as is described in the gospel reading. Because, as many of you know, in that day, feet were filthy. Sandals in the dusty streets of Israel. The only people who washed feet were slaves. And in the hierarchical system, a slave was property, not entirely human. Someone to whom one could do really anything with impunity. So, of course, it was the slave that washed feet. And it was, in fact, really beneath the dignity of anyone else. It's not just the dignity. It was beneath the humanity of anyone else. Because the way slaves were treated in that culture, they were not entirely human, at least the way they were treated. No wonder Peter is horrified. He is scandalized. Every taboo has been broken. Lord, you will never wash my feet. He's uncomfortable. He's angered. It's an incredible breach. He's been thrust in a situation for which he is entirely unprepared. And Peter, who, of course, as you know, has no filters whatsoever, says exactly what's going on in his mind, wherever he is, just blurts out in this kind of burst of real horror. Lord, notice what he called him. Lord, you will never wash my filthy, filthy feet. I have a lot of sympathy for Peter. I have a lot of sympathy for Peter because, quite honestly, if I could get away with God not washing my feet, I might be pretty happy. Because you see, for Jesus to wash the feet of his disciples as a declaration, notice, of having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. This being both a demonstration and an impartation of that love. To feel fingers between my toes. To touch those places on my feet where I'm still a little ticklish. Puts me in an extraordinarily uncomfortable position. I'm giving, in essence, to have my feet washed by Jesus is actually giving him to touch any area of my life. Any area. No more is there the outward self that looks good, and then the inward self that I sure hope nobody notices. Jesus, in this act of feet washing, choosing, in essence, to come behind that false self that is worn on the outside and touch those places that I would rather be kept secret, thank you very much. Of course, I've been set up. Colic for purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. But if you say that often enough, the impact of it won't hit you quite as hard, perhaps. And so this act makes visible Cranmer's prayer, the collect for purity, coming in and intentionally touching us in those deeply hidden, private places. Oh, you see, it gets at my fear, because my fear is that if the hidden things are exposed, I will be exposed. Anyone will see everything. And then, God, what will I do? Worst fears realized, condemnation rearing up its ugly head, and in fact laughing at me in my shame, cackling with delight, because the very thing that I did not want shown has now been profoundly revealed by everyone, to everyone, and worst of all, to the pure, spotless Lamb of God. Where shall I go? And to my utter surprise, His perfect love comes into those places where there is fear and where there is shame, that does not want to see the light of day, and with such extraordinary gentleness, like beginning to quietly open the door of a very dark room, shines a little bit of light, and the light shines on a small child in the bed, afraid. And the gentleness with which the Lord approaches that terrified child, the child within me, is so tender and so kind that I can't help but take the covers and pull them off of the front of my head to look to see who it is that speaks to me with such extraordinary gentleness, having loved me who was in the world. He loved me to the end, to the greatest degree, without reservation, without condemnation, only light, only love. And the cackling, horrific voice of condemnation is killed, slain, like the dragon in the book of Revelation, as love and light steal into that room and envelops that child with a warmth that up until that time he has never, ever known. That's what Jesus does. Something that no human could ever, ever do. That's actually what happens when we come up here to the rail, to literally ingest into our system the bread of life and the cup of salvation. Similarly is the invitation of asking Jesus himself by his Spirit to come into the very depths of our being, to touch places inside of us that no one has ever touched, except in fear, except in anger, except in shame, except in condemnation, and to build up within us a stability in his love, a security in his love that will not let us go. And out of that, to create within us, as Paul says later, a new creature that is learning not to be afraid, a new creature that is finding a level of poise and dignity rather than terror in the night, monsters under the bed, the next person coming into the room, slamming the door open with rage. No, all of those dragons have been killed in the warmth of his light. Beloved, do not let the repetitious rhythm of what we do rob you of the radical nature of the invitation for Jesus to come and to touch deep places in you, not for condemnation, but for joy, for light, for freedom, because that is what he offers those whom he loves, and that's us. We have been invited. That's what I hope why you're here, to somehow steal away from what's happening out there, to just come for a little while and be here in the presence of God. I saw something on Twitter not too long ago that said this: in our day, politicians act like rock stars. Rock stars act like politicians. And yet, where is Jesus? Out of the limelight, washing feet. That's where we are. We're out of the limelight for now. We're in a quiet place. We've been invited to be in his presence. Will you ask him in, that this night we might be strengthened to walk with Jesus in these next few days through the horror of the cross to the triumph of his resurrection. Amen.